Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jo de Ruiter. I welcome you to this symposium on rate of force development. I have the honor to introduce to you the first speaker of today, and that will be Dr. Nick Maffiuletti. He actually is the organizer of this symposium, so he deserves all the credits for this interesting program. We have two great speakers after him also. Dr. Maffiuletti is the director of the Lower Extremities Neuromuscular Research Laboratory at the Schulthess Clinic in Zurich, Switzerland, but he lives in France with his family, so I take it he travels quite a bit. His expertise is on neuromuscular function in athletes and patients. In addition, he knows everything about electrical stimulation, not only as a research method and also as a training method, both in sportsmen and in patients. He will now speak about methodological issues regarding the measurements of rate of force development. Nick, thank you for organizing this symposium, and please go ahead.
Well, Joe, thank you very much. Thank you for being here. I want to officially thank Jacques Duchateau and Peregard for accepting to be speakers right after me. And I'm going to quickly introducing why we decided to organize this inviting symposium. I had to explain it to my father last week, and I simply told him, okay, there is one of the sexist outcome in terms of muscle function in the last few years, that's rate of force development. Then it's more difficult to explain. I simply told him that's a sexy topic. That's a sexy outcome, that's an actual outcome. And there is an increasing interest in the scientific community. So if you look for rate of force or torque development in Web of Science, and you look in those specific fields, for example, these are the number of publications in the last 20 years, and you can see that's quite a lot increasing, especially after 2002, where there has been a paper that has been quite a pioneer in the responsiveness of rate of force development to strength training, thanks to Peregard. So we're going to try to look at this parameter, which I think if you ask almost anybody working on rate of force development, he or she will tell you that's more functional and relevant than MVC strength. There is some evidence for that, and probably Jacques Duchateau and Peregard will speak about that afterward. That's a relatively accessible, it's pretty easy to measure, and worthwhile. Easy to measure, quite easy to understand, and potentially more interesting than MVC strength. What do we try to do today is I will focus on the assessment. So my presentation will be essentially on the methodology to measure rate of force development. Jacques Duchateau will address the neuromuscular determinants of rate of force development. And Peregard will speak about the implication for sport, elderly, and patients. After leaving from here, this symposium will help you to improve three things: how to evaluate range of motion, rate of force development, how to interpret rate of force development data, and how to apply this data to your specific population. And as a note, you probably have already noticed in the program for Malmo, we are organizing another invited symposium on rate of force development on some other features of the one we present here, together with Tony Blazevich and Jonathan Folland. So let's start with my talk, which will address, again, the basics for the evaluation of rate of force development. What I will try to do in more or less 20 minutes, because I want to leave more space for the two next speakers, is trying to review the most important methodological aspects, and I have to acknowledge that my presentation will be not comprehensive, so I apologize if some people will not find exactly what they want, but that's a matter of time. I will provide some general recommendations. Whenever you see a red font like this one, these are recommendations for me, and I will try to suggest future direction for collaboration. Something I would like to do out of here is try to publish together with somebody some recommendations for the evaluation of rate of force development that are based on this approach. So I will try today in 12 points, which ranges from planning, some assessment, evaluating, analyzing the data and reporting the data into a paper or into a report for a patient, try to address all these 12 points. So I will try to do that slowly, as clearly as possible. If you need my slides, just send me an email. I will send it to you. I think we have to reason a little bit on that in an attempt to promote a more valid and standardized procedure for evaluating range of motion. Again, rate of force development. I made a talk about range of motion last week, and it's not the same. So remember, the approach is PEAR, P-E-A-R. Remember the 12 points? We're going to jump one by one from the different points addressed here. Number one, define the purpose of the evaluation before doing a study. And you basically have three kinds of studies. Remember, that's crucial. These are, for example, three studies from our three labs, from the three speakers. Number one, predictive. I think the majority of the studies on rate of force development are trying to relate one outcome that is very important for us. Like, for example, in this case, with a total knee arthroplasty, a score that tells you something about physical function, with rate of force development. And this is predictive validity. So we try to relate one outcome that is important, that could be jumping, that could be something else, to rate of force development. And a typical approach is to show that the relation with MVC is not as good as the relation with rate of force development. Second aim, that could be evaluative, so the responsiveness of rate of force development. That's the study of Per Ogart, the pioneer study I referred to in 2002. These are the effects of heavy resistance strength training on rate of force development. And there are quite a bunch of studies on the evaluative properties of rate of force development. And number three, and there are also discriminative studies. That's a study from the lab of Jacques Duchateau, showing differences in the rate of force development as a function of maximal torque between young and elderly individuals. And here the purpose is discriminating two populations, men, women, old, young, patients, healthy people, involved leg, uninvolved leg. Remember, this is the key of all kind of studies you can perform on rate of force development. Second point, once we define the aim of the investigation, of the evaluation, let's move immediately to the contraction. What do we want to do? Do we want to focus on single versus on multiple joints? And the more I do studies, the more I follow and try to follow this model with both athletes and patients. Do we use voluntary or stimulated contraction? That's very much depending on the aim of your study, and I'm not sense to give you recommendations on that, because you have to decide that. That could be maximal and submaximal. We do more and more submaximal trials, because we don't want patients to do maximal contractions, and you can have very valid estimates of explosive strength by using submaximal contractions. I will show you later. You can do isometric or dynamic, and you have to know that the lab of Jonathan Folland demonstrated that concentric rate of force development is almost twice isometric and eccentric rate of force development. And finally, you have to decide what kind of contraction you want to use. A sustained one, like a classical MVC, where you ask people, like here, to produce maximal force and to keep it for a while, and then you estimate from the slope the rate of force development. Or you want to ask people to perform brief contraction, which is probably the best proposal here. So very short, less than a second, as quick, as explosive as possible. And from that, you get rate of force development and relaxation. Or you can have, according to a recent study, alternative consecutive contraction. That's the study. And these are the alternative consecutive, so agonist, antagonist, with consecutive contractions, very short explosive contractions, where you get rate of force development for the two muscle groups. That's an important choice. If I have to choose, I will never use the sustained modality anymore. Let's move to the variable, and in this way it's pretty simple. So muscle force, joint torque, EMG activity, and I call it the variable that is actually recorded, while on the right side I call it the outcome that is derived out from the variable. So the slope of force or torque as a rate of force or torque development, normalized or not, the impulse, the area under the curve, the scaling factor, we're going to see afterward what's that, and we are trying to focus on that more and more. Or you can even do calculations related to the time with respect to the EMG activity. Something that is important here and you have to be aware of is the reliability of rate of force development. That is, in at least five studies published until today, less compared to the reliability of MVC strength during whatever kind of contraction. So rate of force development is not as reliable as MVC, unfortunately. And what we also have to say is that peak rate of force development is probably the most reliable parameter, and it's also the more commonly used one. And the shorter the time interval, the lower the reliability of the rate of force development variables you estimate, until the worst reliability, which is still acceptable for EMG parameters that you know have more limitations than the force or torque traces. This is an approach we are trying to follow more and more. This is the famous rate of force development scaling factor. So we basically ask people to perform several very short contractions, and these are magnified exactly the same contraction you get here, 20%, 50%, 80%, 100% of the max. This is less than a second, about 500. Out of that, you calculate the derivative, and then you plot the peak rate of force development of all these data as a function of the peak force, and you use the slope of this relation to assume this is an indicator, a good indicator, and a pretty valid indicator, as we showed in this paper, for rate of force development. The good thing is that we can do that with patients, even at low intensity, because we can stop the contractions here. We can use hip muscle, not only knee muscle. 80% of the studies are done with knee, but for sure you can adapt it to other muscle groups, and so on. Afterward, you have to choose the dynamometer. For the dynamometer, I don't want to say too many things. The most important thing is the sensitivity of the load cell of the measuring unit should be as high as possible. Cushioning should be as low as possible, and it frequently you buy dynamometers with a lot of cushioning, and that has an effect on the steadiness of the contraction. So you need to remove cushioning. That's not very painful to do contraction on a very steady apparatus like this one. And the calibration. You also have to say that many isokinetic dynamometers actually have limitations for investigation of rate of force development, because actually the initial part of the contraction is not obtained within the load range. So actually you're not really studying isokinetic contractions. So that's probably a big limitation to consider. After planning, so in your lab, you need to move to the lab with your patient, with your sportsman, and you need to evaluate. Before evaluating, you need to focus on the settings, and for the settings, these are arbitrary recommendations for force or torque, but there are papers, for example, published in which the sampling rate is 100 hertz, which is pretty low, especially if you look on very short time intervals like here. This is a 10 millisecond rate of force development. If you use 100 hertz, that's 1 point on your curve, which is probably too low. For the EMG, you know very well, but also you have papers in which this Nyquist theorem is not respected. Look at CNIM recommendations. So it should be twice the highest frequency of your bandwidth for the filter of the EMG. An important point is also related to isokinetic dynamometers. Many times you have isokinetic dynamometers with an output to your analog to digital converter, and data come out at 100 hertz. Again, remember, that's a limitation to consider, or you need to avoid this pre-filtering. And then you have your patients in front of you, so you need to start testing. So instructions. For me, this is the most crucial point. Instructions in the way that you need to plan a separate habituation session with at least 100 to 200 contraction, rapid contraction, which have the good point that they do not create a lot of fatigue. But we know from this study that we need at least 300 contractions to avoid or to attain a plateau in the maximal acceleration capabilities. So you need to habituate your people to fast explosive contraction. And as many as possible, familiarization trial before the actual measurement, so the day of testing. We also know that it's very important to provide a written and verbal indication using simple and clear instructions. And the instruction should be very fast and short, like the contraction we saw before, less than a second, and short as possible, as fast as possible, or fast then strong. Never use the instruction fast and strong, because if you use that, so these are the settings in this very good paper, actually. On a leg press with elite athletes with unilateral, bilateral movements, this is the MVC for unilateral with the takeoff leg, with the lead leg, with a bilateral contraction. In the blue is the fast and strong instruction. In the orange, fast then strong, which means focus for a second on fast contraction and then try to increase your force to the maximum. And basically you get the same MVC, which is okay for MVC. But if you do RFD calculations, you can see a very significant difference between the two conditions, especially when you do bilateral. So this tells you that here you are, if you use the instruction fast and strong, you are underestimating radial force development. So remember, the instruction is crucial, always fast for very short contraction, or fast then strong for longer contractions, where anyway your MVC estimate will be okay. Feedback, that's also a very good point. So you need to provide a strong verbal encouragement before and during each trial. Our personal approach is the simplest, 3, 2, 1, go. Every time you have to do a contraction, there is a go, trying to stress the most important parameter in performing the contraction, which is the intention. Remember, that's a pioneer study by Dave Bem in 93 with Digby Sale on the intention to contract. And the intention to contract is much more important than the type of contraction you perform. And you need to stress this kind of part. And then you need to provide online visual feedback, not of the MVC score, because that's not your main outcome, but of the rate of force development. So besides showing the curve, what we do is try to show as a percentage, because actually our patients do not understand the units, Newton meter per second, that doesn't make very sense. So these are 5 contractions, and we try to normalize to the highest contraction. And that's also pretty useful to see the variability between the 5 contractions. Whenever we have less than 10% of variability, we are happy. Pretension, so you have to be very careful and account for pretension before each trial. And we usually do that, as it is done in the lab of Jonathan Folland. We magnify the torque signal just before the contraction. And then you will see very well if there is a counter movement, if there is pretension or not. We account and we try, and you need to account for post-activation potentiation, because Stéphane Baudry showed very well the effects of potentiation on evoked and voluntary rate of force development. And Joe and other people also showed the effects of temperature and time of day on the evoked rate of force development. So you have higher values in the evening compared to the morning. You have higher values with higher temperature. And for sure, you need to record at least 3 to 5 good trials per condition, optimally 10. Filtering. So once you get the data and you go back to your lab and you analyze your data, you have to correct for gravity in case of gravity-dependent position. You have to justify and describe filtering, eventual smoothing of your data, and the characteristics of the derivative, which are not always provided in papers. And this is a very common filtering that is suggested by Winter and used in the majority of rate of force development studies. And then you need to focus again on the outcome. So for the outcome, you need to describe in detail all the calculation steps, whatever the outcome you decide to consider. Give priority and give order to your main outcomes. Do not provide too many outcomes that are redundant. This is an example of how you should justify and how you should describe clearly the different steps to arrive to the final outcome. So this is pretty well done. You have the experimental traces, which is also an important point to address in rate of force development papers. You have clearly how the onset of EMG is determined. You have clearly how EMG is analyzed during a specific time interval. That's a study of Enzo Caffarelli. And then, finally, you have to give a rationale to the onset. And these are the basic onset used for the quad. So the values are slightly different for other muscle groups. And to the time interval you show. There is a paper published in 2012 showing that automated calculations of the onset are more reliable than manual. People believe that, okay, I see when there is an increase, that's the manual determined onset. That's not as reliable as the automatic one at, for example, 2.5 MVC. And remember, regarding time interval, if you do repeated measure, if you look for responsiveness of rate of force development, this is not as reliable as this one. Okay, you have more variability here. This is an example, again, if you want to focus on specific time intervals, remember that whatever the condition, the different time intervals can tell you something different in terms of physiological mechanisms behind rate of force development outcomes. This is the correlation, for example, between the rate of force development and the MVC. So the longer the time interval, the higher the correlation, almost close to 0.9. for rate of force development with MVC. So the same determinants basically account for the two parameters. And the shorter the rate of force development, the higher the correlation with a twitch rate of force development. Scaling is also an important factor if you have people with very different characteristics. If you have kids, for example, justify any eventual normalization. Remember, for me, this is pretty good, the proposal of Slobodan Jaric, normalizing rate of force development as well to body weight if you have torque, and to 2/3 of body weight if you have force outcomes. And the same EMG, there have been both proposal, maximal M wave to account more for peripheral changes or simply normalizing the EMG to the MVC. And finally, the reporting, so how you present your data into a paper. Always provide experimental traces to give credibility to your measurements. That's a very important point. And to be more clear in what has been done, what has been quantified, what has been found. Present always individual data. That's an example from a paper with pre and post data from different subjects, and also with the changes, with individual changes. And one more time, this kind of representation together with the standard deviation and the standard error of the mean give more credibility and more clarity to your data. So I hope it is comprehensive enough. This is a little bit what I think could be useful to do in the next few years. Focus on multicenter studies for providing normative data. We don't have normative data, actually, for rate of force development, while there are at least in the world 50 labs measuring almost in the same way. And we need to come up with normative data to provide validity to this outcome. The effect of time of day, feedback, posture, and arousal on the voluntary rate of force development should be demonstrated. And there are a bunch of ideas and possibilities in this way. The return to sport and the injury risk can be addressed. For example, this is a paper who focused on the return to sport decision for elite athletes, and they consider rate of force development as a better outcome than MVC to clear people, athletes, to return to sport. And regarding the prediction of injury risk, there is actually a hamstring to quad ratio published in this paper that has been suggested to be quite promising, but we are still in an early, very early phase. And after this talk, I would say, okay, what about rate of force relaxation? Because we always focus on the beginning of the contraction, and actually rate of force relaxation is correlated to 0.9, to rate of force development. So maybe we're gonna have some more ideas in this direction. And I thank you very much for listening to me. If you have some questions, I will be more happy.
And indeed, we have some time for questions. Thank you, Nick, for this very good practical overview. Are there any questions from the audience? Yeah, Neil.
Hi, Neil Tillin from University of Roehampton. You presented some data where you're obviously looking at rate of force development during dynamic contractions. I just wonder what you do to deal with the confounding influence of change in joint angle and angular velocity.
Sorry, changes in?
Joint angle and angular velocity.
Mm-hmm. Good point. I don't like it very much. I don't like actually dynamic rate of force development. I don't think it is much more functional than the isometric one. I think we introduce a lot of variability. Theoretically, I mean, there could be a procedure to account for the joint angle position. There could be also isometric trials at different joint positions to account for that. But that's actually something that remained to be clearly investigated for me. But personally, I don't like very much the dynamic measurement of rate of force development.
The approach we've tried is trying to determine maximum voluntary torque as a function of joint angle and velocity, and then normalizing to that so that you can compare across mm-hmm. different types of dynamic conditions and speeds and so on. Can I ask one more question?
Yeah, go ahead.
You mentioned about determining force onsets and the manual method being more reliable. I just wondered if reliability was the important issue and whether maybe more validity was what mattered and perhaps manual approaches were more valid.
Mm-hmm. I mean, to my knowledge, the only study really focused and really tried to demonstrate differences between manual and automatic calculation of the onset was the one published in JEC in 2012. For sure, also in this way, there are plenty of possibilities. The manual approach is very arbitrary. And one more time, we surely could find a good way to do manual identification. And what I have to say is also that the manual determination of manual onset, the reliability was not that bad. So it was worse than the automatic one. and it was not that bad. So actually, there could be a way to improve that.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, welcome.
Well, objective criteria are always good, I think. Over there, there's a question.
Tom O'Brien from UK. You suggested normalizing rate of torque development to body size or an allometric scaling.
In case of need.
Mm-hmm. And you suggested that we might be able to do that for adults versus children. Well, we know that in terms of the MVC, either isometric or dynamic contractions, that doesn't scale very well between adults and children. I wonder if rate of torque development would scale well in a way MVC maybe doesn't, and also what the need for scaling, what is to an extent a self-normalized parameter in a lot of ways anyway, if you normalize your torque to MVC anyway, and also it's a time relevant parameter as well as absolute magnitude.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I didn't say we need always to normalize
to
scale the data.
No, you could. I was just asking.
In case of need, we can normalize data. For example, with an intervention, with a training study, where there could be changes in body weight, for example, in elderly people, where we don't focus on muscle. For example, we don't have access to muscle mass.
Yeah.
We don't know the physiological cross-sectional area. That could be an option. Again, very few studies actually normalize rate of force development. And I don't think scaling is optimized for those studies I have seen. But I think that there is one single parameter, so the rate of force development scaling factor, so the slope I showed in one of the first slides. Actually, it has been suggested by the people proposing this approach that this kind of slope doesn't need any kind of normalization. That's already scaled. That's why rate of force development scaling factor.
Yeah.
And it has been used in several studies where elderly have been compared to young people. Young people have been compared before and after training, after ballistic training. So I think probably that's the best outcome to avoid normalization of data.
Yeah.
But I agree with you. I mean, that's not optimized today.
Great.
And
thanks.
Especially for kids, there should be a bunch of things to do.
Yeah. Cheers.
Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you. Slobodan Jaric, United States. We rarely question relevance, functional importance of rate of force development. But we also know that the rate of force development at least moderately correlates with the strength, force of the same muscle. On the top of that, you already mentioned that reliability of rate of force development is also moderate. And we know that tests typically show highest correlation with the same test. So reliability is generally a limit to which another test can correlate with the same test. So what about the possibility that rate of force development and maximum force tested on the same muscle basically assess the same mechanical property of the tested muscle?
I mean, if you look at the correlation study done by Anderson and Ogert, for long rate of force development, for time intervals, I think beyond 200 milliseconds, the correlation, the simple correlation, then, I mean, correlation doesn't mean necessarily relation, but the simple correlation between rate of force development, 0, 200, and MVC for the quad is as high as 0.9. So we are probably measuring a very similar performance. Probably the determinant are very similar between the two outcomes. And then the interest comes when shorter time intervals are used or when outcomes alternative to the specific time interval normalization, like a rate of force development scaling factor, are considered, for which today, I mean, there is no evidence for any kind of outcome to say that that's probably more related to neural function. But that's what people working on rate of force development scaling factor are trying to suggest. That's probably neural function is a little bit more determinant than muscular properties for the scaling factor. But I agree with you. I mean, for long time intervals, like a 0, 200, 0, 300 rate of force development, we are assessing something very, very close to the MVC. In healthy people, then, I mean, the story for me is very different in patients.
Yes.
I think the situation is very, very different. I think patients are more
reliable to test when they do very fast contractions, especially at submaximal intensity, because they don't have any trouble, they don't have any fatigue, they can do many contractions, and they know it is submaximal, they know there are no risks. And the MVC assessment, according to our patients, at least orthopedic patients, is probably not a very valid indicator of muscle function, because it is very submaximal.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay, we have just time for a quick question. Huub has been standing there for quite a while.
Brief comment, Huub Maas from VU University. I want to comment on your final remark on the rate of force relaxation. I think it's certainly a good idea because several animal studies have shown that fast type muscles, or muscles consisting of mostly fast type muscle fibers, respond differently to rate of force relaxation than rate of force development on the at different lengths. So, for example, if a slow soleus muscle changes the rate of force relaxation with length substantially, but doesn't change the rate of force development with length. So I think that's certainly something to look into.
Thank you. I would like to add that also in functional terms, like, for example, from sport, we know that, but also if you think an old person who has a perturbation, it is very important to relax, to contract quickly, but I think it is also very important to relax very quickly and to control the relaxation phase. That's why, I mean, that's simply a suggestion. There are studies on rate of force relaxation, but mainly from evoked contractions, so from a twitch, from a tetanus. But that would be good to look also at voluntary rate of force relaxation and see how it behaves with different kind of research questions.
Yeah. Maybe specifically when you look already you expect changes in fiber type, for example, with space studies or.
Probably will be a challenge during voluntary contractions to not use the antagonist muscles. But I think with it, with this final remark of Huub, we will end this presentation of the first speaker. Please give him a big hand, and we. Oh,